Everyone loves happy hour, and no one makes an hour happier than actress, comedian, author, host, and self-proclaimed hat girl, Dee Dee Sorvino, who each show serves up an hour of good times and great conversation. Food, culture, fashion, current events, history, or just good gossip, grab a cocktail and take a seat as Dee Dee shares stories, talks with friends, and makes you wish you could keep the bar tab open all night. Where there's a party, there's Dee Dee, and you are invited. Sit back, relax, and enjoy Drinks with Dee Dee. Here's your host, Dee Dee Sorvino.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome to Drinks with Dee Dee. We're going to have so much fun today. I'm Dee Dee Sorvino, your Emmy award-winning host. I'm not always good at it, but sometimes I can be. So, you know, tune in and stay tuned in because it tends to get better and better as we go along. So welcome again. We drink on the show. We talk on the show. It's a virtual bar, just bar talk. And that's where the best conversations are. As you all know, if you hang out at bars, if you never go to a bar, then it's a good thing you're here so you can have that experience in your life because it's a good one. I always have an official drink on the show. Ask the guests to just come and I'll give them the topic and say, have a drink. And that's it. That's their prep. And it always works out really well. We don't do scripting here. We just want you to show up, have fun, join the gang. If you're feeling lonely, if you're feeling sad, tune in to this program. And what do you do for a podcast? Do you say tune in? I feel like that's so old-fashioned, although I am old-fashioned. But podcast, you know, what is the official word for that? I guess I'll have to ask everybody. I'm not sure. I'm not sure tune in is, but you know what I mean. So since we're talking about today, the Snazzy SAG Awards. Now, look, it seems like the award shows have kind of gone by the wayside, but I love them. I can't help it. Hate me. It's my thing. I love award shows. I don't know. I just can't help it. My husband, Paul Sorvino, does not. He's like, I don't like watching these things. I don't get it. I'm bored. So he goes and he watches tennis or takes a nap or something while I watch. So he's a good sport. But the official drink of the show, because it is an award show and I always like to have an excuse to drink champagne, is Veuve Clicquot. Ah, love it. Love you. Love Veuve. It's the best. If you've never tried it, you must go get a bottle right away. Now, I have ice in it because they delivered it warm. So, you know, you can't have warm champagne. I asked them to deliver a cold bottle. I didn't get a cold bottle. I got a warm bottle. That's okay. I love drizzly anyway, but I got a warm bottle. So there's ice. It's not even a champagne flute. It's a wine glass. So sue me. But anyway, it's still good. It's still great. So thank you for joining us. I love it. Check us out on all podcast platforms. Tell your friends if they're sad and they're bored or whatever. You know, join us because it's always a party. So you know what? Since it's a party, I mean, look, I'll talk to you all by myself. I can go on and on for hours. Those of you all know our podcast used to be like 3 hours long or something. Now it's an hour. Now it's a tighter program, you know, because broadcast is interested and it's easier to get the show onto platforms when it's an hour long, not 3 hours. You know, not Gone with the Wind. So I think we just get going. Toast to all of you. And let's bring in our guests. Let's bring in our bar buddies. While I'm having a drink of my Veuve Clicquot champagne. Carmen, Carmen. Hey. Deep in the heart of Texas. Bum, 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 bum. Deep in the heart of Texas. Carmen just moved from California to Texas. Let's all congratulate Carmen for the big move. So great. I know you love it better already, right?
Except for the ice, but you know.
I knew you were going to say that.
I'm from Buffalo, so I can deal with it. It's all good.
Yeah. I'm like, you're a Buffalo girl. That's nothing. I mean, winter in Dallas is never going to be anything. But I'm so glad you made your move from California to Texas. That is so smart. But you're a smart woman. That's, you know, I expect no less. Michael, nice to see you. You know, you look like you've got your beard under control. For once.
It's out of control.
It usually looks like there's like animals in it or bugs or something, but you know, it looks pretty well groomed. Well done.
Thank you. So Carmen, thank you.
Okay, so we got a lot to talk about today. We got a lot of great guests. So Carmen, you're in Texas now. Jeff, just so you know, darling Carmen.
Hey, I like Texas.
California to Texas. That's awesome. She's such a smart lady. What is your drink today to celebrate your move?
Champagne.
Champagne, me too. Veuve Clicquot, baby.
Hey. It's
an award show. We had to celebrate. Michael, your drink. It. Don't say Hornitos.
I am drinking coffee and Woodford Reserve minus the coffee. Hail.
Hold the coffee.
Nice. Kathy in Miami, what do you have in the drink?
I'm changing things up, a Cuba Libre, which is
what the hell is that?
A Cuba Libre is like a free Cuba, but it's Coca-Cola with rum, Bacardi rum.
So that's a Mela. Okay.
I'm waiting for
my way to say rum and coke. I love it.
That's funny. Cuba Libre, yeah. And there is no free Cuba, so there you have it. It's like a lie, a drink that's a lie.
Yeah. Oh,
it sounds
okay.
Way cooler when you say Cuba Libre.
Yep. Yeah, it does sound nice. I didn't understand a word of it, but now I'm glad to know it's a rum and coke.
Yeah,
please don't tell me it's a Diet Coke. Don't tell me it's a rum and a Diet Coke.
No Diet Coke.
You know that you can have cocaine and coke.
Mm-hmm. Kathy, they call it the real thing now, and it's not the real thing now.
Yeah, they used to have cocaine and coke. That's so Miami. It's perfect. Oh, and you got a lime.
I got my lime.
Welcome to Miami. Do they still do lines of coke and, you know, on the bars, like right on the bar, in the bar scene? They still do that, don't they? I know they do. You don't have to lie. Podcast, everything's legal, right?
Allegedly.
In the bathroom, not on a bar. What's wrong with me?
Go to the bathroom.
Oh, you go to the bathroom to do lines of coke. Okay, well, enjoy your rum and coke. Tom Anderson, Mr. Movie Guy, you're doing great with all your stuff. What do you have in the drink today?
You won't believe it. I have my drinker bell cup, but I'm drinking Gatorade because
bye.
It's 6 o'clock.
Moving
I got
on.
A live show.
Yeah,
with
mute.
I don't care.
Mute.
Moving on. Bye-bye. Okay.
Mute.
I got to do a live show at 6. I can't be drunk.
Jeff, don't disappoint me. I know you're going to be a hard drinking Texan.
Well, you know, I can pretty much forget about going to the gym this afternoon now, but I've got my Texas class with the bullet in it. You seen that? Take that out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I got one of those. Those are sweet.
I'm drinking an old fashioned made with my friend J.R. Ewing's wonderful bourbon. But I do also have to mention, because I just got back from the Super Bowl, and our Super Bowl sponsor was Cabal Tequila. This is their premium Blanco. It is made from all virgin soils. It's the first harvest of agave off of those soils. It's a wonderful, wonderful tequila. If you like a very good, fine sipping tequila, Cabal Tequila. Okay, commercial
Cabal
done.
Cabal Tequila. What an interesting name, Cabal. Huh. Well, all right. So moving on over. So what do you got, Stephanie?
I got a glass of Cabernet. I can't remember. I can't read the bottle from here.
That's okay. It's red wine. That's all that matters. It's usually Kathy's drink.
$25, and it's worth it. It's pretty good.
$5?
$25.
Oh, $25. Okay, I was going to say that's a little more. That's a little better than $2, Chuck. Not much.
$5. That's almost box wine.
Well,
not that there's anything wrong with that.
No.
So Kurt, tell us about the other podcast you cheated on us with. No, it's all family. But tell us about the podcast. Yes, he left us for another podcast.
Wait.
You
make
it
sound incestuous if
he's
cheated within the family.
Two-timing informational font of wisdom.
No.
No apologies?
I'm just polygamous now. I'm not when it comes to podcasts.
Did you move to Utah?
Yeah. Going down to Utah is the place that I want to be.
No,
it's Osmond. How bad is that?
Yeah.
Really bad.
The producer of this podcast asked me to be on one of his other podcasts, so we kept it in the family.
Ew.
Don't say it like that.
Yeah.
That's what, you know, Michael and Matthew both thought of that. So I'm just teasing you. I think you should do everything and everything with Tony. It's grace and congratulations with that and all your hits.
Yeah, that one was called Truth Be Told. And I told all the truths about life on other planets and black holes and astronomy and stuff like that. So yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Kurt said black hole. Matthew's the star of the show because we're talking about movies, we're talking about the SAG Awards, and he is our wonderful film critic. And I'm always amazed about all the info that he has. But what drink are you having first?
I just cracked this open for you all this week. Bushmills Red Bush.
Ah, yeah, Red Bush.
What
black walls, red bushes. I mean, it's
what is that?
Wait, is this the Ireland podcast?
Irish whiskey is not just for March anymore.
And Bushmills is in Northern Ireland, so they get in a big old damn fight about it. Jameson, right. You know, and the you know,
oh, well.
You know, I mean, it's kind of a fight over there.
But what is it? What is Irish whiskey as opposed to whiskey?
Like, oh my God, really? I can't even. She didn't say that. Someone, please.
It's like saying, what's the difference between bourbon and whiskey?
Yeah.
That's like, yeah.
Right, yeah.
It's basically Ireland. Whiskey. It's made in Ireland.
Yes. Is that it?
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
Okay.
I showed up today. I love it. So, yeah. Jennifer, what do you have?
And bourbon, like Dee Dee Binky, is made in Kentucky.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right. The real bourbon.
Charred oak, bourbon barrels, minimum 8 years.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Looking like a true Kentuckian. He was born there. Mm-hmm. Good thing. So, Jennifer Hoosier, what are you having?
I'm just being boring and having a little Bloody Mary.
That's not boring. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Hey, I recognize the Bloody Mary. It doesn't have 45 food items sticking out of the bottle, out of the glass.
Just people some, like that. I hate that.
A rack of ribs, a hot dog, some bacon.
I hate that.
I literally had one with a burger on a stick. It's not a joke. In Golden Country.
As a garnish.
Seriously.
See, for me, a drink, I mean, I'm going to get to the liquor, so you're all shocked. So, I mean, if I have to dig through that and throw it out, well, that's less liquor in the glass, for one thing. And right. It just takes more time. So I said, please don't put all of that stuff in the drink. I don't know. Do you all like a frou-frou drink? Do any of you like that?
Nothing wrong with it. I don't mind it, depending on the circumstances.
Yeah, once in a while, I'm not into sweet.
Especially on holiday, like vacation.
I like what's it, Malibu and pineapple.
Yeah.
Well, a piece of pineapple, that's kind of cool.
If you put a smoked Negroni in front of me, I won't be unhappy.
Okay. Yep. Same.
Well, olives work for me, so okay, that's about as far as it goes. I don't know. But hey, you guys, so you know, I think we're getting back to normal, sort of, kind of, other than that war going on, which we almost talked about maybe next week. But I thought, since it's supposed to be a happy podcast and a fun podcast, we stay away from the war stuff. And we talk about SAG Awards, which is sort of a war because, you know, there are the actors competing. We have a lot of actors here on this podcast. Mm-hmm. I like to include actors because they're interesting folks. And some of you may not be actors, but you probably have had your foot or your toe in something, like Kurt. Stand-up comedian. He's a father, but he's also a stand-up comedian. And Matthew, hello, is a director, an actor, and a film critic. And it just goes on from there. The talent goes on and on here. Matthew's comedian Michael, even though he's never funny, but that's okay. We bring him back anyway. That's joking, Michael. You just got an award. Flip mode, you got another thing, right?
And this time, Texas recognized me. The Texas Short Film Fest in San Antonio. So,
congratulations.
Very cool. Good job,
Tom's Michael. Got stuff going. Jeff's got stuff going. Make a shout out before we get into the war. So you all have anything to promote? Because we have like a gazillion followers. So who has a project that they're working on?
I was just in American Trash. We filmed last weekend in LA.
Is that a show that I don't know about? Is that a show?
No, it's a film.
Wow.
It's what the Bay Area people call me.
American. It's a catchy title and it fits. So
Michael was in rare form today. I think he started drinking early.
That's just Michael.
That's good because he had COVID, he couldn't drink. And I don't know why he thought that was a bad idea to drink. I swear, I still don't get it, but at least he's back in the saddle again.
I swear to God, bourbon is what got me over COVID. It was when I started drinking bourbon that within 24 hours, I was better.
See, Michael, you definitely had the wrong strategy or the wrong doctor. From now on,
I know.
Whiskey. No, all right, everybody. So let's talk a little bit about the SAG Awards. And I've heard, I don't know for sure, but I've heard, and Jeff, you may know, you go out to LA a lot. Are they able to not wear a mask now? Or is you know, able to go in restaurants now? I heard that just changed.
They literally lifted the mask mandate the day I left. I left on the 15th. The Super Bowl was that Sunday, the 13th. I left on the Tuesday, the 15th. And that was the day they lifted their indoor mask mandate. prior to that, anytime you go indoors, any building, restaurants, whatever, any building, you had to have a mask and your vax card to even get in the door.
And you know,
and after
you know
9 days
messed
in
up.
LA, I literally had sores on the top of my ears from all the masks.
Yeah, and you know, we got by security, we ditched the mask.
And so what's crazy is this doesn't even count for schools. In my county, the teachers
don't
wear masks, so they're protesting.
Yeah,
I'm like, fire their asses.
Yeah, in California, the kids still have to wear the mask in the schools, so the kids who are at the least risk still have to, you know, do the thing. And there was something else, but anyway, the mandate still has for the kids. Also, Los Angeles County has a county mandate, so if you're inside LA County, you still have to wear your masks inside.
Yeah, but I heard in Beverly Hills, they just kind of do this to LA.
Yeah.
I mean, I kind of think Beverly, or that is what I've heard. Because
well,
I was asking.
The ticket.
Well, if you're the LA mayor and you're at the Super Bowl, you could just hold your breath.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, right.
Kind of after the Super Bowl. I mean, I'm not surprised that they lifted it right after the Super Bowl, because really, I mean, after they did see everybody without the mask on, it's really tough to.
Well, they announced it. They announced it the Wednesday before.
Oh, I see.
It always blows me away. It's like, okay, we're going to lift the mask mandate next Tuesday because that's the day.
That's the day there's no more COVID.
Giving COVID. Because if we do it on Monday, that's too soon. If we do it on Wednesday, that's too late. So it's next Tuesday is the day. And of course, I love the fact that I guess as long as you're chewing or drinking, you can't spread COVID.
It.
So that's nice.
I mean, that lollipop that lasts forever. What is that lollipop that, you know, has like a thousand licks or whatever?
So on my flight back home, I literally nursed the same drink for 3.5 hours. So I never had to put my mask on.
The alcohol will kill the virus, won't it?
There you go.
Of course.
I have seen some studies.
Yeah, no one in Orange County ever wore the mask or they enforced it. So, you know, everybody in the OC was like, whatever.
Right. Oh, absolutely. Right.
Yeah. And you know, it's Dallas County, isn't it? Texas is going to be even more like, well, forget that.
Oh, nobody here. Oh,
Texas like, blew this shit off a year ago. Yeah. We've been a year without masks. So
Florida, I liked it when I was there. I saw no masks or M95, and I just pictured the debates.
You saw a slight uptick of people wearing masks when the Omicron, you know, got really crazy. But that's people's choice. If people choose to wear a mask, I have no problem with it.
And that's fine. Wear a mask all day. Wear it to sleep. Yeah. Wear it in the bath. Wear it in the shower. Who cares? But I don't want to have to wear it.
Yeah. So when the Omicron came, you saw a few more, but now it's back to, you know, you don't really see them around unless it's like an elderly or a sick person, you know.
Well, it'll be interesting to see what happens with the awards, because the award shows have sucked like crazy since COVID. Because they put them in a garage and like there are six people there and nobody's clapping. And it's just horrible. So I'm kind of counting on the SAG Awards to be good. I'm hoping they'll be good again, you know, because if you were on the show last year, because we talked about this last year, you know, the actor, the award, actually, it's a guy, but it has no wiener. So I think they're trying to include everybody. The award is kind of a pretty award, but it is kind of weird. Have you all seen it? Kurt, didn't you have the picture of it?
It's right there.
Oh, yeah.
So you mean the trophy doesn't have a sagging piece between his legs?
No.
Michael!
It's snazzy, not saggy. There's nothing there.
I know it's a good joke when Cathy yells at me.
Classy, Michael.
Oscar says your point is...
You know, I like the award. I like to talk about, you know, the actual awards. I think Oscar is the most boring award of them all. Emmy is beautiful. I just think that which is called the actor, the Screen Actors Guild. Yeah, there you go. The Emmy is beautiful. Probably the prettiest award. Golden Globe, I can barely remember. I think it's like a stick with the globe on it, so that's kind of boring too. But I like the actor. I think it's interesting because it's got a kind of a patina on it and people can barely pick it up. And I think, you know, if you want to be inclusive, that's the way to do it. You just have like a guy with a helmet and no wiener. So it could maybe be a girl. It could be Florence Nightingale or some woman or Minerva or whatever. So anyway, enough of that. But I think it's a pretty award.
Have we clarified what the SAG Award statue's pronouns are?
No, that's not confirmed.
That's what I was saying. I think it's every.
Yeah,
it's
but see, genitals doesn't have anything to do with it. It's all about choice and choosing your pronouns. So
I think the pronouns are usually mine, 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 and mine.
You would have to ask. Anyway,
that's against every actor at the SAG Awards. They want that award to be mine.
Mine.
Yep.
I mean, I think that's a clever way to do it. They were clever before all the pronoun stuff with having the soldier guy without a wiener, because it could really go either way. It's like, well, I guess I could be a woman with a kind of build, whatever. Anyway, let's get off of that and about some of the awards. That's pretty mild, actually, for this show. But I think that there's some interesting choices. Have any of you? Well, here's the thing. I know that Jeff is a member of SAG. Tom's a member of SAG. Who else? Anybody else here? So they send out send out all these screeners. So if any of you want these, I'll send them to you, because we really never, you know, we rarely take a look at them. But you know, and Paul and I get double. So they send the screeners out.
Yeah.
And you can look at them virtually, but I like having something in my hand. And so I just
unlike the SAG statue.
Phrasing.
Right. It's nice and smooth.
There's nothing to put in his hand.
Yeah.
I know you're sad about that.
I've been watching the digital ones, and it's just, you're right.
See, I just like the old-fashioned. I like having them in my hand. So, well, Tom, if you've watched it, you know, is anything standing out? Any of the movies standing out for the awards? Anything you like? No.
I liked the Ricardos.
Ricardo.
You did.
I thought Simmons was amazing in it.
He was the best one in it.
I watched it and I thought it was good. I was surprised at the casting of Nicole Kidman. I heard an interview with Lucy Arnaz,
yeah,
and they seem to be very happy with the casting. So of course, if they're happy, you know, it should be. And I watched it and it was good. You know, I would have liked to have seen some things done different, but I thought it was pretty good. I don't know.
You're a Latina. I'm sorry, Jeff. What?
I was saying, I don't know if there's a SAG award in it for him, but I thought they both did very good. Javier Bardem played Ricky, and Nicole Kidman played Lucy. So it was, and I thought he did very well. And he caught a lot of crap because he's not actually Cuban; he's Spanish.
Right.
And so he caught a lot of crap from the Cuban community. But I thought he did. I thought he did very well. I mean,
that's what I wanted to ask Cathy. Cathy's Cuban, so what did you think of Javier?
Yeah, that was the problem. So when these movies come out, it's like I read all about the controversy first, and then we interview the stars, usually if they're Hispanic stars.
Javier, you have some splaining to do.
So the Ricardo story is such a fascinating story anyway. I mean, they basically built Hollywood. So they had such an amazing story, and the book came out like 10 years ago, I think, and it was meant to be a movie. And then when they chose these two actors, and then he wasn't, there's so many Cuban actors out there who are amazing. And then they chose a Spanish actor, and then they chose Nicole Kidman, and then it just didn't seem right from the beginning.
Yeah. It was recast several times because it took so long to get it into production. So it was,
you know, I didn't like the casting at all. I just didn't like it. Nicole Kidman looked weird, and Javier is not cute enough to be Desi. Sorry,
you know who I thought would have been great for Lucy, and she's actually portrayed Lucy in some things, is Deborah Messing. I thought she
would
have been really good.
Well, a couple things. One, there's a documentary. There's a documentary that's coming out that Amy Poehler did called Lucy and Desi. That's coming out next week. So, I Messing would be fine, except how, you know, look at Deborah Messing's film track record. If we're going to go into the business side of this, when you say they were miscast, who are you going to cast? And with Aaron Sorkin, it's going to be names.
Good point.
Yeah.
But I just couldn't get over it. Nicole, didn't work for me.
I would have went Emma Stone for Lucille Ball.
Maybe, in the early years.
And then Ryan Gosling to play Ricky to really.
Oh, come on, Ryan Gosling.
Yeah. I'm with Michael.
He's so lame.
Just dye his hair black.
He's as white as possible, and he's terrible and not even a good actor.
He's in line with Hollywood.
What's the difference? I mean, look at
really blew me away.
Anyway.
You know, I never thought Desi Jr. really looked like his dad or looked like really either one of his parents, because, you know, I grew up watching the Lucy Show when he was a kid.
Oh, I thought he was so cute. I thought he did.
And so I never thought Desi Jr. looked like him. But if you remember a movie from, I want to say, maybe the early 90s, maybe in the late 80s, called The Mambo Kings. Y'all remember that movie? The Mambo Kings. Desi Jr. played Desi Arnaz in that movie. And God, he was the splitting image of his old man.
See, I like that.
I mean, he looked and sounded like his old man, like I couldn't even believe. And I never thought he looked like his dad until I saw him when they did the hair and put him in the shoulder pad suit with the, you know, the the baggy pants and the whole thing. He was great.
And now that we have the de-aging process.
All right.
Yeah, no kidding. Yeah.
Well, I think we should just go down the list, guys, because we've got a big crew here, and, you know, and just pop in and say whatever you like, because I'm sure not, well, except for Matthew, you probably haven't seen every movie, and you know every single factoid about it. So some of you know these, some of you don't. So
let me say one thing about being the Ricardos before we move off of that. My friend Magnus in Iceland, who was
Magnus
before,
is my friend too.
Yeah, he went to see the movie there, and he said that hardly anyone could understand it, because if you don't know Lucy already, that film isn't going to make much sense.
Right.
And I think to any audiences that don't have the American cultural experience, and he's a fan, he's a big fan of American culture. And that's partly why he's my friend.
But I have a list of persons played in reruns all over the world for.
But see, he didn't grow up on that. He wasn't familiar with it. So he didn't get the movie.
Wait, Icelanders do not love Lucy.
They don't know Lucy.
They don't love Lucy.
Magnus. Maybe Magnus was just high. I'm kind of thinking this is a Magnus thing.
No, he doesn't get high, unfortunately.
Did you introduce him to Lucy? Did you try to find anything online? Or,
you know, they put out those colorized versions, the new colorized versions.
No,
this really high tech thing.
No,
and no,
see,
no.
Female empowerment route. She invented the rerun.
What you should do is you should see the documentary on how they do it, because that's fascinating. But I told him I gave him that set to get him into it, because I think if you jump into the black and white, if you don't already know it, you're not going to get it either.
Here's the deal about our culture. They look at things like the now, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like they get, when I was in Germany, the Friends thing was going on, whatever. And the Lucy, Ricky, the Lucy, Desi story is a very American story.
Yes.
So people who are familiar with her being a white girl.
It's Marianne, two American stories in one.
Yeah. It's that was controversial right there. So it's, I can understand why they wouldn't get into it. I mean, if they don't understand it. So be like, I get it. I get it, Magnus. I get it.
I don't agree with that. I think everybody should be able to get it. Magnus, you just let Magnus down. He needs to watch a few more of those reruns. I love Lucy's great. It's not rocket science. It's just funny and fun. And so if Magnus didn't get it, that's on him. Okay, so let's go through the list.
He's been on ice for too long.
Well, no, right. I told him to start with the Chocolate Factory episode.
There you go.
Yeah.
I prefer the Stompy
and the Benjamin.
I don't know how to translate Vitamita Benjamin into Icelandic, though.
I can't even say it.
Already sounds Icelandic.
There is no translation.
Okay, folks, so what do you think about this? Outstanding performance by a male actor in a television movie or series. Murray Bartlett, The White Lotus. Oscar Isaac, Scenes from a Marriage. Michael Keaton, Dope Sick. Ian McGregor, Halston. Evan Peters, Mayor of Easttown. Any thoughts? I liked Halston. I'll just throw it out there. I thought it was really good. Now it's an Indiana connect, right, Kurt?
It is, yeah.
Oh, The White. I actually watched the White Lotus series, and this hotel manager guy, he did a good job with his part. I thought that was a pretty good show. And even though it's a drama, it has a lot of funny moments because Mike White produced it, who did School of Rock with Jack Black. So
no real big feelings on that, huh?
I'm a big fan of the original Scenes from a Marriage, which was originally an Ingmar Bergman miniseries for Swedish television. that they later made into a film in the early 70s. So, and you know, between Oscar Isaac and Jessica Chastain for what, 3 hours? That's pretty solid.
Mm-hmm.
There's a cool story with White Lotus. This one kid got casted because he did a video audition, and the casting director was making fun of his apartment. He's like, this guy's gross. Oh, he's so poor. And then it wasn't muted. And he goes, well, you know what? If you casted me for this part, I wouldn't be so poor. I could get a better apartment.
Yeah.
All right. So how about a male or female actor in a television movie or series? Jennifer Coolidge, The White Lotus, Cynthia Erivo, Genius, Aretha, I have no idea what that is. Margaret Qualley, May, Jean Smart, Mare of Easton, or Kate Winslet, Mare of Easton.
Ooh.
There's a bunch of good ones there. Jennifer Hudson
Jennifer Coolidge
was amazing.
Kate Winslet was amazing.
Yeah, Kate was really good.
Yeah. But I mean, Jennifer Hudson channeled Aretha Franklin in that movie.
You mean
really
Cynthia Erivo. This is the Genius Aretha, not Respect.
Oh, right. That's right.
Yep. If you get a chance, right, find the Saturday Night Live sketch that makes fun of the accents of Mary Easton.
Water. You want some water?
Yeah, water burger.
All right. Outstanding performance by a male actor in a comedy series. Michael Douglas, he's great. Comiskey Method.
Comiskey is great.
Yeah, it is. Brett Goldstein, Ted Lasso, not a fan. Steve Martin, Only Murders in the Building. Martin Short, Only Murders in the Building. And Jason Sudeikis, Ted Lasso.
Sudeikis, yep. Yeah.
I gotta say Steve Martin.
Steve Martin.
Yeah.
I love him. I love him. I always have him.
I would go there too.
I got Michael Douglas because of his performance in that, being an acting coach. Anybody that's lived in LA playing an acting coach, he knocks it out of the park. Because the one girl in his class gets famous and then they all hate the girl. And he's like, hey, we used to all be happy for people back in the day. What's the matter with you guys?
He has some great monologues in that series. He really did. I'm torn. I love the Kaminsky. It's great. Michael Douglas is phenomenal in it. I love Steve Martin and Martin Short. And you know, Only Murders in the Building is awesome. If you haven't seen it, you got it. You got to check it out. There's another season coming. But, you know, I've always been a huge fan of Steve Martin. I've never been so big on Martin Short. But you know what? In watching this, Martin Short did phenomenal. I mean, I enjoyed him more than I've ever enjoyed him in anything before. So as much as I'm torn between those three, I'm going to go with Martin Short just because I think he went beyond himself a little bit in this one. And I think he did a really great job.
Oh, that's a good point because he's usually not that spectacular. He's good, but he's not great. But he was great. He's
very, very good in this. And his character has a lot of twists. He's a little deeper than the other two. I thought Marty did great. I'm team Marty on this one.
That's a really good point because I had them tied, but you brought some really good stuff about Martin.
Well, let me just throw this in here that Jason Sudeikis did a great job just being himself, just like not acting at all, right. Zero acting.
I don't get that.
Yeah.
At all.
Well, his uncle is George Wentz. Did you guys know that from Cheers?
Well, that's not cool, isn't it?
No,
that's his uncle.
Not that I have a
George
problem.
George Wentz from Cheers.
Right.
Michael, did you say George Wentz from Cheers?
Yeah, that's his uncle.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
Nice.
Wow. All right, let's go with the best female
I'm
actor.
I'm Team George because George did some videos for my classes.
That's right, he did.
He did, yeah.
Yeah, he's great. How about female actor in a comedy series? Elle Fanning, The Great. Sandra Oh, The Chair. Jean Smart, Hacks. Juno Temple. Ted Lasso and Hannah Weddingham. Ted Lasso.
Jean Smart, baby.
Jean Smart did really good. I appreciated her more and more through the years because I think it was Designing Women was the first time I ever met
her.
She's had a great run.
Phenomenal in so many other things.
My favorite Jean Smart was Frasier.
She was dating and smoking the cigarettes and oh my god, that was so funny.
Stephanie, that's
you're
so good.
Put your hand in my ass and walk in and then we're gonna make out. You know? God, that was funny.
I haven't seen any of these, but just my love for Jean Smart makes me vote for her. So
That show hacks. If you imagine a Roseanne character, hanging out with a woke, like, liberal chick, and then they're like bashing each other. It's a great show.
Okay, I'm still watching this. I'm making notes now.
Yeah, Hacks is great. It's really great. Yeah,
I agree. That's a good one. That Jean Smart is just, you know, what I love about Jean Smart, because she just can go on and on and on and on. A lot of times the women are has-beens at 32. So, you know, if you can find a way, and it's not fair, but it is what it is. So if you can find a way to stick around like that, I mean, good for you.
Well, yeah, Designing Women was the late 80s.
The mayor of Easttown and Hacks at the same time. And they came out about the same time. And that different characters.
I didn't even recognize her in Mayor of Easttown. Yeah.
I didn't even catch it. That's news. I mean, but Lugger and Hacks, and you're right, Jeff, that was 100 years ago. Great show, but that was a long time.
Remember, she was also the president's wife for 2 seasons on 24. Mm-hmm. Where she was the first lady on 24, but she had mental issues, and Glenn Morshauer, her Secret Service agent, had to protect her and do all these things. So, I mean, she's great, and she's a very versatile actress that she doesn't get credit for.
I think we all collectively vote for Jean Smart. I literally voted. Yeah. Did you vote yet? Tomorrow's the last day, I think, to vote. Mm-hmm. So we get to vote. You're in, it's amazing I'm in a union, but you kind of have to be to do any acting. So, Reagan was president of the Screen Actors Guild, so we get a pass, right? We're able to do it. But that was a big vote. I thought Jean Smart was outstanding and way above the rest. So how about performance in ensemble comedy series? The Great, Hacks, The Comiskey Method, Only Murders in the Building, and Ted Lasso.
Again, tied between Murders in the Building and Comiskey. I just love those two.
I thought Yellowstone was in this one.
That's a laugh riot.
So maybe for the Academy Awards, but I'm pretty sure they're going to get shut out at these. You have to remember, this is Screen Actors Guild voting. It's a different type of vote.
Yellowstone is television, so that wouldn't be in the...
And we may get to that. I don't know. I don't quite remember all of it. I kind of ran into these quickly, so... All right, so let's
move. Yellowstone
is nominated as best ensemble in a drama series.
Okay, well, that's coming if we get to it.
All right, what was comedy again?
Well, we're moving
on. Ensemble.
We're moving on. You missed it. Sorry, Michael.
Your list is in a different order than mine. So I'm
up high, down low, too slow.
Michael ruined it, as usual.
All right, so this is by a male actor in a drama series. Brian Cox, Succession. Brian Cox, Succession. I can't even say it.
Careful.
Cox on this one.
Michael.
What? He's a great actor.
My God.
Billy Crudup, Morning Show. Kieran Culkin, Succession. Lee Young, Yay. Sorry if I got that wrong. Squid Game and Jeremy Strong, Succession.
I'm a big Brian Cox. He's a great storyteller, and you know he's been working in the business for decades.
Who, Matthew?
Brian Cox.
Yeah, that would be my.
You got Cox on this one.
Cox and Succession.
I love Succession.
You have a phone call. Mike Hunt, you have a phone call.
Now we're in The Simpsons.
All right, moving on. So outstanding performance by female actor in a drama series, Jennifer Aniston, The Morning Show, Young Ho Yen, Squid Game, Elizabeth Moss, boy, she's nominated for 500 years. She's been nominated for the last 6-7 years. Sarah Snook, Succession, and Reese Witherspoon, The Morning Show.
I think Jen Aniston.
No boss.
I think Jen Aniston in that show, the show sucks, but she's good at it. She shows her dramatic side.
I agree with you, Michael, 100% on that one.
I spell it morning.
Yeah, what were you going to say?
Well, I don't know, Kathy. Did you see that one?
I actually did not. And that's the one most people have asked me if I've seen, and I refuse to see it. but I wonder why. And but that's the one that gets people the most excited, and they loved Jennifer Aniston. They loved Reese Witherspoon in it. That's the one I've heard about the most all year. So I guess that's everyone's favorite. So
I think Matthew's going to be with me on this. I don't like that show. I don't like the actresses in it. I'm not a fan. I don't think they act well, and I don't like the show. Yeah. But Matthew, I don't know.
I like the show. It's really hard. I don't like the show.
I don't like it. I think it's horrible.
Yeah, no, I think season one was better than season two. Season two was just too long.
I don't get it.
I haven't seen it at all, but, you know, I love Elizabeth Moss. I love her in everything she's ever been in. But, you know, Handmaid's Tale has had pretty much every award in the world thrown at it for how many, 5 seasons now?
Exactly. And
so I'd like to see somebody else get something. I think that show's run its course, but I haven't seen Morning Show, so I can't really.
Yeah, don't.
Well, season one's okay.
Something impolite about Jennifer Aniston, but I wonder that either.
Matthew, I don't know. I maybe you haven't seen it, but I don't think this is your type of jam, so.
I haven't seen any of these.
Yeah.
So.
Well, okay. With Morning Show, in the second season, I just stopped watching, and then my wife goes, "Hey, one of the main characters died," and I go, "I wish they all would die."
Yeah. Moving on. Okay, here's an ensemble. Here we go. Yellowstone.
Yellowstone.
Yeah. Ensemble
in a drama series: The Handmaid's Tale, Morning Show, Squid Game, Succession, and Yellowstone.
Succession.
No competition, Yellowstone.
Yellowstone.
No other competition out there.
Well, Succession's great, but Yellowstone's better. I agree.
And next year, you're going to see 1883 all over the place. It is going to kick some major ass.
It looks awesome. I haven't got to see it yet, but it looks awesome.
It's unbelievable. It's the best thing since Lonesome Dove.
Trace Adkins was performing in Reno, and somebody booed him. So he jumped down off the stage and he talked. He's like, "Why are you booing me? Why? Why are you booing me?"
I love it.
It was great.
He's already said he will never do any other movie in his life that is not a Western. He will now only do Westerns from now on. He absolutely is loving what he's doing right now.
I guess that's just the cowboy in him.
Ice. My favorite line in Yellowstone is Beth. I'm the tornado through your trailer park.
Right.
Every line from Beth is my favorite line.
That's the dream role is to play Beth. That's awesome.
I would do it.
I thought you tucked it in your sock, Bob.
It's, you know, the award is for ensemble in a drama series, and you look at the diversity of these characters and how deep each one of these characters are in their own way and how much conflict there is between all of them, and be able to maintain that now for 4 seasons. They're just unbelievable. And I've got 2 friends that work on the show, and they say it's just a joy to work on that show.
But they need to get you on the show, Jeff.
Believe me, I've been up for 3 parts on it, didn't get any of them, but I'm working on it.
Next time, okay? Let's all...
I could totally see you being on the rodeo crowd, Jeff.
Totally.
I'll be in the rodeo crowd. I'll be the guy at the top just sitting there, you know? I think it's really something, and it's going to go down in history. But 1883 is really, which is the prequel to Yellowstone.
I heard about that.
Is going to be unbelievable. Of course, Sam Elliott's always the bomb.
He is.
So next year, you're going to see 1883 all over these awards. Mm.
1883, Sam Elliott.
Oh, yeah.
He looks like my ex-fiance.
Good for you.
I can.
Does anyone dislike Sam Elliott? My whole life, I've never heard a single bad word about Sam Elliott.
No.
People love Sam Elliott, and they should. Great. I loved him in Roadhouse.
He's freaking beautiful.
Oh my God, I
loved him in Roadhouse.
Of course you did. But yeah, I actually, on my podcast, the guy that I hired to do the voiceover for the intro to my podcast, I specifically hired him because he sounded like Sam Elliott.
That's a good voice. Oh, doesn't get any better than that.
I have a question. When it comes... we're all ringing. If all of you seem to like, you know, particularly you're voting and you like one thing, how is it that there's such a disappointment? Like, what if the Morning Show does win in this category as the best ensemble? Like, how did such disappointments take the day? Like, how does things like that happen that it's like, whoa, where'd that come from?
Because the rest of the world's not as smart and brilliant as we are.
Is that what, seriously?
Yes.
Yeah. And
she surrounds herself with the best and brightest. And so, right. You know, I can't help it that the rest of the world can't keep up with us.
Like, everyone's on the same page, but then it's like, then there's these huge disappointments. Like, where did that come from? Like, there's always these out of left field type of things.
Well, every award show has different voting. I mean, for the SAG, it's just the members. So that's totally different. That's kind of
this is actors voting for actors.
People's Choice Awards, sort of, kind of, but it's within the union.
Yeah, and White Lotus, they got it right with Jennifer Coolidge, but there are some other good performances in there, too. So I can separate the two.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, so moving on, folks. So best performance, outstanding performance by a female actor in the supporting role. I cannot say this word. Catriona Balfe for Belfast?
Mm-hmm.
Kate Blanchett, Nightmare Alley, Ariana DeBose, West Side Story, Kristen Dunst, The Power of the Dog, and Ruth Negga for Passing.
None of these. I've seen none of these.
I'm really glad Ruth Negga got a nomination. She should have gotten an Oscar nomination for this, but I think it's Ariana DeBose's to win.
Really?
I mean, it's a tough call because Kirsten Dunst has been in the business forever, and... Right. You know, she's now in a new phase in her career. Cate Blanchett could read the phone book and be on the show and be riveting. But the fact that Ariana DeBose is picked up where kind of Rita Moreno left off and does the triple threat of singing, dancing, and acting, which is hard to do in 2022.
Mm-hmm. I'll go with that. You got me to switch my vote from Cate Blanchett.
Yeah, me too. I was kind of going with Kirsten Dunst, but I'm like, Matthew told me.
And I love Cate Blanchett. She wants to be Lauren Bacall in this so much.
Yeah, which is great. But you know, I haven't cared much for Kristen Dunst since she got rid of the cheerleader outfit. But you know,
just, oh my god.
Oh, you didn't watch Jeff, show where
I think her husband Jesse Plemons will tell you she still has it.
Hey, yeah, that's
right. What do you think about that, Kurt? What are you thinking about those comments?
I'm just listening. I'm my confessional for later.
You're so sweet. You're not going to say anything. Yeah, no, I like these guys.
Kurt, you're not going to show Bring It On to the late to the gang at the shop?
Yeah.
No, I want to watch that show with Kristen Dunst in Florida where she's the preacher, how to be a da 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 da. It's like a sentence long title.
Is that a porn?
Believe it or not, no.
Porn, by the way.
What?
Michael watches porn.
What?
No, yeah, I don't. He loves it. He's addicted.
That's not a SAG topic, Michael.
Well,
I'm actually against it.
Yeah. All right.
Did you wear the cheerleader outfit in that movie?
Outstanding performance by a male actor in the supporting role. Ben Affleck, Bradley Cooper. It's getting worse and worse. Troy Kotsur. Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm not telling you the show. My apologies. Ben Affleck, The Tender Bar. Bradley Cooper, Licorice Pizza. Troy Kotsur, Coda. Jared Leto, House of Gucci. Cody Smith-McPhee, The Power of the Dog.
Well, Dee Dee, you just lost your consideration for award presenter. So,
Licorice Pizza sounds like something that would win an Oscar.
Yeah. I just want to serve the drinks. I want to be the bartender at the party. That's the best job. I'm happy
with that. What? House of Gucci was kind of weird and kind of strange and kind of dark and kind of a lot of things, but there were some really amazing performances in there. I don't specifically remember his, but...
Oh, you don't remember? You don't remember a Jared Leto's performance in the House of the Gucci?
It's been like a year ago that I watched it, so...
Jared
Leto. I thought Jared Leto was handling Saturday Night Live when he was doing that role. I mean,
when I watched it, it seemed like such an
over-the-top thing.
I went on YouTube to find the person he was portraying to see if he was that broad. He's not.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry, he's a not. He's
actually mad.
I want him to make a movie about Jared Leto because he went to India because people wanted to see his band perform, but then he turned it into a cult. Like giving lectures and stuff.
Seriously, Mario and Luigi. Jared Leto, I'm such a clown.
So it's not Jared Leto.
I really like Cody Smith-McPhee.
It's not Lindsay Lohan.
Cody Smith-McPhee has a lot of his scenes with Benedict Cumberbatch in Power of the Dog, and the fact that this young kid kind of stood toe to toe with not only somebody like Cumberbatch as an actor, but with that character that his character has to deal with.
Yeah. I think that's great. I mean, Benedict Cumberbatch is like the new Jeremy Irons.
I love him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with that.
I
haven't seen Licorice. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I have seen the Tinder Bar, and it wasn't as bad as I was afraid it was going to be. But I didn't think it was a huge movie, award-winning type of movie. It was a decent movie for what it was, and he had a decent role, but it wasn't like, woo!
No, but remember, this isn't the Academy Awards, this is SAG. I mean, these are actors, and a lot of it's a popularity contest. It's a different award show.
Yeah, it's a different politics than the other.
I still didn't think it was enough to really have
an impact. I agree with you, but my guess is if it makes the Academy Awards, I'll be shocked. I don't think it's the type of movie that would get there. Matthew would know better than I would.
Thank you, dear.
Well, the Tender Bar disappointed me.
How so, Tommy?
I said the Tender Bar disappointed me because my friend Max Martini was a real asshole in it.
It happens. In Hollywood.
I know, it happens, right?
Wait, so for the outsiders, what do you mean a different politics than other award shows? Because what's different politics? What do you mean?
I don't mean politics like presidential and Congress.
I mean
industry politics, you know. And the SAGs, you've got actors voting for actors. And
right. The
Academy Awards or in the Emmys, you've got the Television Arts and Science voting for Emmys. You've got the Academy voting for the Oscars. There's more influence by the studios and by money in those.
Oh, interesting.
Versus SAG seems to be more, well, at least inside the industry, legit. Whereas the People's Choice Awards, they can just be anything. They can come from everywhere. So. Well, not everywhere, but you know, it's just a
pretty
very
much.
It just seems like a really
gets around and gets drunk
politics like, and trying to get something A nominated and B won.
So, the Golden Globes are 12 members of the international press.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's totally different. Matthew, do you understand how that works completely? Because I've never really quite. And of course, their last award show was shit. It was nothing. It just didn't even happen. Everybody boycotted it. And I always love that one because they go to the table, they get drunk, they have fun, it's a big party.
Which one is this?
The Foreign Press. The Foreign Press one.
Oh,
Golden Globe. It's usually the fun one. And then this year, it just, I don't even know what happened. Nothing.
My favorite moment, the Golden Globes, is Ricky Gervais. That was
hilarious.
Hilarious. I laughed so hard watching
so
that.
Funny. Hilarious.
Yeah,
anyway, before I move on, I do want to say I haven't seen Licorice Pizza, but Bradley Cooper has been someone who's continued to surprise me with things that he's done and how well he's done them. And so I haven't seen that. I don't know what his performance is like in it.
It's kind of comes out of nowhere, Jeff. Licorice Pizza was in my top five. And Bradley Cooper plays producer John Peters. I'm sorry, crazed out of his gourd producer, John Peters. And it just kind of comes out of nowhere, but it fits in with the milieu of the era of 70s California.
Okay. So Once Upon a Time in Hollywood-ish.
Yeah, it's a puppy dog love story in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood clothing.
There you go.
Oh,
you
go. Silver lining.
All flavor. My friends hated Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. I love that
movie. I love that movie.
It's great.
I just love that movie. Did you all like that movie, Once Upon a Time?
I just actually rewatched it about a week ago.
So did I, Jeff. It just, you know, we're thinking about good movies.
It has that similar hang feel. There's a story there. You just got to take time with it.
Right.
Okay. Good to know. All right, folks. Here we go. We are moving on to, and I'm sorry I said Leto, Jared Leto. All right, so outstanding performance by a female actor in a leading role, Jessica Chastain, The Eyes of Tammy Faye, which is crazy they did a movie named that, by the way. So Olivia Colman, The Lost Daughter, Lady Gaga, House of Gucci, Jennifer Hudson, Respect, and Nicole Kidman, Being the Ricardos. Now, I know there are a lot of opinions. What do you think, Carmen?
There's a lot of opinions here. Number one, I think Jennifer Hudson, Respect was absolutely fabulous. I can't think of anybody. In fact, when Jennifer Hudson first, you know, did the whole thing and then did the girls, the
Dream Girls.
Dream Girls. I said, if anybody oh, ever plays girls. Aretha Franklin in a movie, it's going to be that girl. And sure enough, and Aretha handpicked her to play her in this movie. Yeah. And she literally channeled her in this movie. At the same time, House of Gucci, Lady Gaga, I thought was fantastic.
Again, she's weird, really God, dark, she's so bad.
Weird, dark, uncomfortable movie.
I agree, Katie. That was so bad. Jeff, I respect you so much. How in the hell can you think that was a good performance? It was so bad. It was a caricature of some woman. Like, and I'm like, what are you saying? I can't understand you.
If she stands next to Jared Leto, she'll seem more subdued by comparison.
Jared Leto?
I can't.
Jared,
okay, just for that, I'm putting the crazy background back up.
Lady Gaga, just no.
I want to press for Olivia Colman because I really like The Lost Daughter, and if you've seen the film or not, if you see the trailer, it teeters a line and does not go into Fatal Attraction territory. It easily could.
It doesn't. Course.
And so I really did, and I can't remember the young woman who plays the younger version of her. She who also got a nomination, who got an Academy Award nomination, but a lot of internal sadness without turning into big dumb thriller.
Okay,
but in no way for Nicole Kidman for the Ricardos because she didn't channel Lucille Ball, which is the whole
point. No, she didn't.
Yeah. There were a couple. I thought there was a couple of strong scenes, and I even turned to my wife a couple of times and like, oh wow, that almost sounds.
Kathy, if I may counter, the point of being the Ricardos is to not channel Lucille Ball. The point of being the Ricardos is channeling Aaron Sorkin.
Then that's the problem.
That's the point of any Aaron Sorkin.
Yeah. So
that's the point of any Aaron Sorkin production. So.
I kind of think, just generally speaking, the two ladies who had the most awful makeup should kind of be automatically just crossed off. Because
so the
those makeup was so bad on both of them. I mean, I understand what they were trying to go for, and I understand the actual people in some cases, but
TV, the amount of makeup they actually wore was
wow. Really Jennifer, ridiculous. You're right. The total caricature. Yeah. You hit the nail on the head. You know, Lucille Ball was a beautiful woman. And yes. Nicole Kidman looked like, I don't know what the hell she looked like. And Nicole Kidman.
She looked like a mannequin.
She
looked like a mannequin.
Totally. All right. So, we've ripped
I
on that.
I think all of us probably set the bar so high for Lucy because we all love her so much.
Yep.
That how do you go in and be Lucy and not find
She's
something
still
wrong?
On. She, they're still on. Absolutely. You know? Yeah, like my 10-year-old still knows Lucy.
Yeah,
like
we love Lucy. See, so your guy, Iceland guy, totally wrong, Kurt. Even Kathy's 10-year-old knows about
it. Yeah, Magnus doesn't know, but the 10-year-old knows.
And you know, it was so awesome. My first wife was Colombian and spoke very fluent Spanish. And my
How did that go, Jeff?
One of my favorite things when we were dating is we would watch I Love Lucy and she would tell me what Ricky was saying whenever he was cursing her out. And that opened up a whole new level of I Love Lucy for me. And now that I knew what Ricky was saying, it was great.
There was no script
was
for
so
that.
Cute. It didn't matter. No. I thought he was so good looking. That's why
I'm going to tell you. Olegoma Essa is something like
it's you. Totally you, improv. Crazy woman,
something. It just blew my mind when my ex-wife was. We're dating at the time, would tell me what he was saying. And I'm like, oh, that makes
sense. Don't be mad, Kathy, when I say this. Did you get it? Do you have a stab wound, Jeff? I'm just wondering.
Do I have a stab
wound? You're married to a Colombian. I'm just wondering. I don't mean to be, you know, mean or anything, but I mean, you sound like it was a rough time. Do you have any
wounds?
Do you have scars or anything?
Because I never got stabbed because I'm very quick. I remember.
Fast runner.
He's a gunslinger.
Couple of drawers that came flying my way, and but you know she had to put up with me too. So it was kind of a toss. And she's the mother of my three fantastic kids, and we actually get along.
Jeff, you're very mild mannered. You're a mild mannered.
It took us 30 years to get along, but we get along great now. So.
Well, you married an angel. She's a doll, so you're good.
I did, and Heidi, great. Heidi's wonderful.
She is lovely. All right, folks, let's move on to Javier, who I keep bishing about because he wasn't even close cute enough to be Ricky Ricardo. No way. He was too hot. Javier, no. Javier's kind of ugly. No. Okay, so performance by a male actor in a leading role. Javier Bardem, being the Ricardos, Benedict Cumberbatch, The Power of the Dog, Andrew Garfield. Where did he come from? shot from the
boom.
Tick, tick, boom. Will Smith, King Richard, Denzel Washington, The Tragedy of Macbeth.
Ooh.
I gotta check Benedict Cumberbatch.
I really like Cumberbatch in this because nobody thought he could play a role like this. And if you haven't figured out, the man is capable of playing anything.
Yeah.
Also want to say it's just a special shout out to Denzel Washington. If he could stop doing The Equalizer Part 6 and do more Shakespeare and continue producing the plays of August Wilson, I'm for the rest of
Will Smith did Shakespeare too, didn't he?
No.
What, oh, yeah. King Richard? Wasn't Fresh Prince?
Oh, right.
I'm sorry. I thought
it's not King Richard like that. What are you talking about? That's
what? King Richard.
Is this the tennis racket I see before me? Is that what you're saying? That's...
No, it's about tennis. Okay, we got 4 minutes and three categories, and I want to get through them
about Shakespeare. Come on, focus, people.
Here we go. Quickly. Outstanding performance by a cast in a motion picture. Belfast, Coda, Don't Look Up, House of Gucci, King Richard. What do y'all think?
Mass is not on this category. Gucci. Next.
Don't look up.
Either one. Belfast or Don't Look Up.
Well, I'm glad you didn't say House of Gucci. Thank goodness. All right. Outstanding action. Oh, yeah. Outstanding action performance by a stunt ensemble. Jeff, you do stunts. Black Widow, Dune, The Matrix Resurrections, No Time to Die, Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings, whatever the hell that is.
Shang-Chi.
Okay, let me get the first one.
Shang-Chi. I like Shang-Chi. Probably out of those. Shang-Chi.
Yeah. I have to say, as a stuntman, you've got two Marvel films nominated in here, and then, of course, a James Bond film. But when you have as much money as Marvel, you put together the best teams and do whatever you want to do because they just spend money like it's not even theirs. The Matrix, I think the stuntmen are great and they do an amazing job. But by the time you get to the finished project, the deliverable that goes into theaters or to the screen, there's so much CGI and everything else that the actual stunt work gets whitewashed or washed away.
I love The Matrix.
As great as it is, the actual work of the stuntmen, and as great as it was, you don't actually see their work. You see images of something. Of course, Time to Die, all James Bond movies have great stunt work and everything.
Yeah, except that it wasn't Time to Die. That is very bad.
No. True.
Yeah. Okay, last category, folks. Last one. Outstanding action performance by stunt ensemble in a television series. Cobra Kai.
Oh!
The Falcon and Winter Soldier. Loki, Mayor of Easttown, and Squid Game.
I'm with Kathy. I like Cobra Kai.
Me too. I love Cobra Kai.
Yay. It's so fun.
Say Cobra Kai. I can't.
And also, you know, they've got like 12-year-olds doing it. You got to give them credit.
Yeah, I think that's one of those sorry, I'm from Texas. Embedded.
That's racist. You know, I don't know why.
We have the ties to the original movie, and we love seeing these guys come back. And yeah, there's some bad performances in that, but at the same time, I think the stunts and the kids are doing phenomenal in that thing.
So
I love Billy Zabka. He's so funny. Okay, so we're at the end. Everybody, I hope you watch
it.
I think it'll be kind of fun. We made it. And let's do a picture, Kurt. Let's do a toast.
Oh, yeah.
Do the SAG Awards. I'm in SAG. Jeff's in SAG. Who else is in SAG here? Oh, I'm sorry about your
mic. I'm eligible.
You're eligible.
I'm NPR. All right, guys.
I know Michael.
SAG eligible just means he's not serious. So anyway, no. Sorry, Michael.
Later. Everybody's
I'm trying.
Smile. Who's taking the picture?
Kurt. There he takes many, and then we pick the best one of all of us.
Okay, we're done. We're done.
We're done. All right.
You got it?
See y'all.
We're done. All right. Great job. See you all. Bye.
Anyway, fun seeing you guys.
Bye.
Bye.